the work you've done, any thoughts or like technology you are using, or is there anything you want to learn? So this is the place for you. All right, thank you. And thank you for coming. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Bazos from I work for the Straits Times as an interactive graphics journalist there. I'm also co-organizer for Hacks Hackers Singapore, so thank you all for coming along today. It's really good to kind of kickstart this again. Thank you to our wonderful speaker. So Hacks Hackers, if you don't know, is a global kind of chapter organization that started in the US, of course, with the New York Times and various other news organizations. The biggest chapter is in Buenos Aires. There's a big chapter in London as well, and in Australia, all over the place. So you kind of get connected to all sorts of journalists and things around the world. Now, the point is to bring together journalists, developers, designers, data scientists, anyone that's kind of interested in the field of learning how to tell stories in a more interactive or digital way. And data visualization is kind of one aspect of that that we use, but we do look at virtual reality and any kind of other new things that come along our way. So thank you very much. I'll hand it over to our speaker. You have something to present.
Actually not really, but I just wanted to do a quick one on this one is Jake, but I need to ask for email in here.
I'm gonna try to. I think it's live.
Hi, my name is Jill. I'm also one of the organizers. Actually, I started both groups, so I brought them together. So I started both Hacks Hackers SG and also Benefits SG. But basically, I help curate and run all visualizations on. If you write a visualization or you create any visualization on Singapore, we would love to link to you. So basically, this is what SG I used to is a community site, right? Where basically any visualization, right, that created from the ground up, right? And they're actually useful Singaporeans, right? We just link to them without. So you find a variety of interesting stuff from transport, taxi availability, and a variety of things. So if you need more information on where, on what we are trying to do, they're all in the info segment there at the top. But if you have created any visualization, you want it showcased, come talk to me, okay? That's about it. And now we'll pass over the floor to our speaker, Jin, who will go through with us on subject topic. Okay. That's up.
Newsroom unicorns. So basically, it's journalists who can code, which is really rare to find in newsroom. That's why we're called unicorns, not because we're magical. So here I'm talking about briefly how data visualization and data in general was utilized in the modern newsrooms and how specifically we're using data at Reuters. So at first, it's a very simple question. You may find this very naive. What does data mean to us as journalists? I don't know for you guys, if you're doing like a financial analysis, business analytics, maybe data just means numbers. For us, majority of the cases, yes, it means numbers, but it also means many other things. So it means numbers, real information, maybe also text. So for numbers, we had this piece which is about China's debt problems. And this graphic is basically built up on 100% on numbers. Because we have a very big piece trying to explain how bad China's debt problem was. It was a really hot issue last year. People always talking about China has a really serious debt problem. But if you write it in text, you say, hey, China has this many debt. It's really worrying people. But you get how bad that exactly is. And if you compare that to other countries, is it really bad or good? And what really caused this bad situation? So this is the purpose of this graphic. We try to explain everything. And so we started with how bad this is. We're trying to compare China's total debt to GDP compared to other rivals like Japan, US, and Europe. You can see Japan has a really high ranking, but what we're really talking about here is corporate debt. For Japan, it's mostly like a government debt because they're using quantitative easing, like they're putting a lot of cash into the market. That's why their government has a lot of debts. But if you only think about corporate debts, China is really like the worst. That's the part people are really worrying about. Like, can these companies pay their debts and what's going to cause them to China's economy? So we're trying to trace back to all the historical data to see how this problem was caused. It's going to trace back to even before the financial crisis, the government tried to buy out, they spent a lot of money to help the companies, and they're encouraging companies to build infrastructures, manufacturing. This one shows there's a really sharp decline in manufacturing because companies don't have any money and nobody's buying stuff, so the manufacturing really done. So what the government did was they're trying to stimulate it. They were increasing infrastructure investments, basically lend you money, and then you can take the money to build some infrastructures which can stimulate economy. And that's basically where most of the debt are coming from, and it's piling up over the years. I will share all the links later to you guys if you're really interested to have a deeper read of this. And also for this, personally, I think one really big benefit of data journalism is that readers can get a fairly personalized experience when they're reading these kind of things. For example, if a text reporter is writing something, she cannot say, hey, in Shanghai, that is like this, in Beijing was like that, list out all the provinces in China. So you can get to know how bad your province is. But for this, we just need a map. And whichever reader they live, they can see, oh, like I live here, Guizhou, it looks really bad. The debt is almost the same as the provincial GDP. So what's wrong with my province? I think this is like a very good thing about data. It provides a little bit of unique experiences instead of very general like news coverage. This is just a cute diagram. And then we also have data to analyzing how the Chinese companies, like how much debt they have. And this one, if their profits can really cover their interest rates. So you can see over the years, the number of we consider as healthy companies, which means their profits at least three times over their interest rates are decreasing quite a lot. Which means even their profits can even not cover the interest rate, or they're not making any profits, which is a really bad thing. Again, if you write about this without using graphics or database, it will take like maybe hundreds of words to explain this, but now you just don't need any text. So basically, this is a graphic purely based on numbers, and it's very clear, persuasive, and very efficient in terms of information conveying. And I will talk about this later. It also refers back to the ways of data collection, because data collection is really important in terms of database. If you don't have good data, what are you going to visualize for? So there are many, this piece includes many resources of data. We grab like public data out there from like World Bank and many other third-party databases. But for Reuters, we also have our own analysts. They do collect their own data and do their own analysis. We also have our reporters in the field. They can literally go to a local government asking for a print paper of the records, which you can never find online anyway because they never publish us. Well, the second kind of information we actually visualize a lot is geo-information. For geo-information, I personally really like geo-information because geo-information also include data points, right? Like you have so many things all over the place. But it's very interesting to see how geographically it distributed and how location really matters in this case. For example, this piece we did is called North Korea's Other Threat. If you follow the news, you know North Korea is really doing something very crazy, and it's all over the news now. It's a very big topic. But people always talk about North Korea's missiles, which can target America, target anywhere in the world. This piece is from a different angle. We're talking about the artillery North Korea have, which may not be as powerful as the missiles, but they have a lot, and they are really close to South Korea. So this is a map. We locate all the hardened artillery sites. Basically are those shelters. If you want to fire an artillery, you have to move your artillery to those shelters. So basically the locations of these dots means where they're going to fire their artilleries. And we plot them with the range. They're like 60 kilometer range each artillery has. So you can see they can literally target Seoul. And then we add a second layer of data, which is the population density. So you can really know how impactful this is, how many people in South Korea or North Korea will be influenced by these artilleries, which tend to be ignored by the media or the people, but they're actually a real threat. But then when you see this, some people might ask, oh, this looks really bad, but do South Koreans just gonna stay at home and be hit by artilleries? And this will lead to our second map. We were trying to see how South Koreans can react to these kind of situations. This is a map locating all the civilian shelters in South Korea. Basically all the people you can hide into these underground shelters, and the size of the dots indicate the size of the shelters. And we also calculate how much space each person needs. So you can get a conclusion like how many people these shelters can take. Actually, I think it can take everybody. So geolocation is very interesting and important here. I mean, it's interesting how many they have and how big they are, but it's also super interesting where they are. And for this, I want to show this. I don't know how many of you have seen this New York Times pieces. It's also going a little bit back to their collection process, but also very geographically interesting. They did a survey in America asking people, do you know where North Korea is? You can just point it on the map. And these are all the answers, where North Korea is. This is scary, because this literally means not only they don't know where North Korea is, they also don't know where China is, where India is, Japan is, anywhere where Asia countries are. Right? Because this is very stupid and scary, but it's very strong. It cannot be expressed in any other ways, in text or video or photo. This is a very useful way. And when I talk about data collections, this will be also one of the cases, because this is one of the cases you cannot get data anywhere outside. You have to do your own collection process. And the third one is text. I think tags usually get ignored when we talk about data visualizations, because they don't look like numbers at all, and how you're gonna visualize it. I have to admit, we don't really do much about text analysis and visualization at Reuters, because it is hard. We used to have this idea, we wanted to visualize, you know, Trump tweets a lot. We wanna analyze how Trump's tweets distribute and get feedbacks on Twitter. Like how many people are retweeting or commenting Trump's tweets and what their reactions are, like negative, positive. They retweet and they say, oh, what a piece of shit. Or they retweet and say, oh, I really support his policy. But it is hard, because when you're trying to analyze text and you try to analyze emotions behind it, it's hard. I'm sure there are experts here. I wouldn't say much about it because like entry level of this. But if you just want to say, like you want to analyze positive narrative. What if I say, hey, I really do not like this? I guess this is easy to fix. You can say, oh, what if a positive word coming next to a negative, like a not, you can count it as a positive. This is interesting, this is easy. But what if a guy really sarcastic, he was like tweeting, oh, what a genius idea. Is that positive? It's definitely negative, right? But I don't think our algorithm could recognize this as negative. So it is really hard if you're trying to make conclusions based on this. But there are some people doing text analysis and visualizations. And this is a piece I recently came up with. The Pudding is a really interesting place. I suggest you check out. They do a lot of database essays like every month, like bigger projects. So this author, she did a text analysis based on film scripts. It's still not that sophisticated. It's not about emotions at all, but it's very interesting. Try to analyze what kind of verbs or characters are connected to different genders. So here, the most words used for women versus men. Apparently for she uses the most used word is snuggles, and then they giggle a lot. Squills. For guys, straps, shot, kills. And they also go a level deeper. Well, you can also explore here, which is the top 800 words paired with he or she. And then they also go a level deeper, trying to figure out if, if the gender of the author also matters. If female is writing about female, is that gonna be different from a male author writing about females? Because we all have stereotypes, subconsciously maybe. So it's something very interesting to explore. But it's not like you have to do a very sophisticated analysis saying that this author is having some positive and negative attitudes towards this, but this is still a very interesting piece to check out. And if any of you are interested in doing text analysis, text visualizations, or if you're experts, I'd really like to talk about this. And also for this author, if you wanna learn more about text analysis, she actually published all her code on GitHub, and she also writes a small book about how to do text analysis with R, which is really helpful. If you are trying to learn something like that, you can check out. So if you have been to our last meetup, maybe some of you have, our organizers mentioned about some differences between visualization the business world and visualizations in the media industries. So he said, in the business world, usually it's exploratory because you guys do a lot of dashboards. And for us, it's mostly guided because we are storytellers, which is mostly true. But actually, we do both. It really depends. So even for exploratory, I think one thing we really believe in is that you don't visualize things because you have a data. Or you just put out a data because you have a data. You're like, oh, I found this data set, and here you go, just look at it yourself. Without any news packs or news angles or anything, we don't do that. But this is one of the pieces we did, which is exploratory. And we published this before they're announcing the Nobel winners. And this is a pure exploratory piece because there's no guided anything narrative, nothing. But you can play with it yourself, and it gives you all the detailed information about each authors, each winners, and you can filter by gender and areas, country, what kind of prizes they're winning, if they're winning multiple prizes, and if they share prizes, if they're still alive. It's just to help readers to explore. I think one very good thing about data journalism is not only we tell stories with a lot of data as evidence, we also provide opportunities for readers to choose their own stories. Because we are all different people, we all have different interest points. So even for Nobel Prize, maybe I'm only interested in women winners, maybe I'm only interested in guys who are still alive. It's just provide you like freedom to have some personalized storytelling ways. But most of our pieces is still guided. We have a story and we have a news angle, and we're trying to guide readers to understand our data, our narrative, step by step. This is one piece we published in June. It's called Dead Arrival. I'm not sure how much you are familiar with the war on drugs in the Philippines, but just to fill the gaps a little bit. So the president is trying to this campaign to kill all the drug addicts, drug dealers out there, so the police can just go out, do the operations, and kill them if they're trying to fight back or resist, if you think they're drug dealers or suspects or addicts. But this gain a lot of complaints, feedbacks from the human rights societies, from all the medias, people saying you were slaughtering people like animals. And then they say, hey, look, we're trying to kill fewer people now. If you see the numbers, like fewer people are dead. But our investigation find out something really different, because so what they were doing is they were doing some cover-ups. The government will only investigate cases if the victims are dead as seen. If they're dead on arrival, they don't do investigations. So what they did in the police records is they mark a lot of deaths as dead on arrival. But apparently they already died before they even arrived in hospitals. So this is the number, the percentage of dead on arrival. You can see like increasing a lot over the times, especially after certain points, because that's, you know, when the media is trying to really try judging him. And we got all these data. Our reporters just came to the local police stations. They actually have these physical records. They write all these deaths with details, but they don't publish this anywhere. So you have to go there and collect information yourself, and you try to analyze it. So we end up like a map like this. So we analyzed the data in two places, Quezon City and Manila. And the size of the dots represents the number of people who died. And then we tried to mark out where these neighborhoods are, because they're mainly those slum or really low-income neighborhoods. And then we're gonna tell you how many of them are actually that are rival. So all these with strokes are dead as seen, but all these solid circles, they're dead on arrival, so which is a lot. And then we also gonna tell you which police stations are related to these cases and which hospitals they got sent to. Collect these kind of information. For this specific case, we have two sides of the stories. The police is telling something which is totally different from what the witnesses and the family members are telling you. The police will say you're a drug addict, and then he's dealing drugs, he tried to fire back, he has a gun, and we sent him to the hospital right after he got shot, and he's still alive when he's at hospitals. And basically you should know what is the witnesses and family members were telling, which is totally opposite. And these are all the informations we collected from the field too. Now we also interviewed forensics. These are real photos, the war real photos, very bloody stain. Basically the area they got shot and they died with a lot of blood, which we cannot really publish. So we chose this way to illustrate the information. So when experts analyze these kind of photos, it can be seen that they're not really trying to fight back. It depends on their gestures and the position they got injured, which means the police were lying. So we would consider these as data too, because they are information, and you also have very unique, if you find a very interesting way to visualize them. So why do journalists need data? I went to journalism school, and my friends, they all want to be great journalists, awesome storytellers. We all want a very touching human faces in our stories, right? We want our characters to have a name. It's Mary who died in this tragedy, who lives right next door, 10 meters from you. So sad. But what we think data can help you is that you find Mary very tragic. It's a very sad story. You find it very powerful. What if I tell you there are tens of thousands of Mary out there? Isn't that more powerful? So that's what we think data can help journalists to tell a more comprehensive and unique and persuasive stories, which is providing context. But there are also many other benefits of using data. First of all, is finding story ideas. Since you're not a journalist, because many journalists have a beat, which is basically the areas they're covering, like you're a commodity, you're covering energy, human rights. So if you're looking for story ideas, you can definitely find something with data, right? If you keep an eye on some data and they're updating this, you see the prices are dramatically increasing. You're wondering why. Or if you see a weird pattern is trying to show up, you're wondering why. This is how data can help you find story ideas. Because yeah, sure, I can also talk to tens of experts to get certain information. Yes, but you shouldn't ignore this way too. And then discover patterns, like we said. If you're writing like a trend story, basically you definitely need data. You cannot say, hey, my source A tell me this thing's gonna happen. How did your source A know this thing's gonna happen? You must have some evidences to back this up. Well, that's why we really need data. But sometimes we also need data to find the outliers. Let's say all the doctors are taking $10 from drug companies, but then you find this specific doctor, he took $1 million. And that's your story. You are not really focusing on the patterns, you're looking for the outliers. Or let's say all the police officers are doing okay, but that police station like arrested 10 times of suspects compared to their colleagues. And that's your story. So that's why we need data. It's not only about defining patterns, the majorities, we also care about outliers. And the last one, find characters. It's a little bit opposite from providing context, because context is you have human faces first. You're trying to show how big the issue is. But what happened to us before was that data can also do the opposite way. For example, if you're trying to find a person to talk to, you're trying to find a war victim or a rape cases victim, it's really hard to find, or a crime victim. You don't know which one is the best person to talk to. So what if you have a complicated data set about crime rates? And then you can try to do a rough analysis to figure out which area has the worst crime rate. Or you can even do further, which street has the worst crime rate. And then you totally narrow down your search. You can try to find a guy who literally lived on this street, try to figure out what happened to him. Then you have a human face. So it's the opposite way by using data instead of like providing context. It can also help you find some emotional or touching content. And then I'm just gonna roughly talk about how the workflow is at Reuters when we do data visualizations. I guess sometimes it's very simple. So first step is collect data, right? Like how we collect data. There are multiple ways. We use public databases like World Bank, IMF, and there are tons of databases out there. And there's so many nice people in the society that collected those spreadsheets, like telling you what data set is out there. And there's so many interesting ones. And there are like data sets, database about UFOs, people saw, and you can plot them on the globe, like where people saw UFOs globally. And then APIs. APIs basically just a different way to query data. We used it mostly for election coverage because we want live dynamic data. But you can also use like Star Wars APIs, Game of Thrones APIs. It just, you know, it's just something very interesting to do a visualized piece for. And manual labor. One example I already talked before is the New York timepieces, how they collected the information by doing a survey. And we also did this one. Sorry, it's North Korea again. We did something about their military parade. You know, they had a big one this year, this April. But we're trying to figure out what kind of patterns they had in their military parade over the years. Actually, they had a lot of them under Kim Jong-un. And you want to see, is there any growing trend or change in terms of the weapons they were trying to show? So you can see what kind of message they're trying to say to the world, right? Like they're bluffing, or they're trying to hide things, or what they're trying to do. But nobody's collecting this data out there. Nobody's telling you, hey, like North Korea showed 20 artilleries, like 10 rockets, 5 missiles this year, or blah, blah, blah. So what we do is we watch all of their parades on YouTube. This year was fine, it's high resolution. The years before was not that okay, I was almost got blind. Plus, we need to figure out exact models of each weapon, like exact models. You cannot say this is artillery. You have to say this is artillery M724. So we have to like stare at your screens and also look at the weapon databases and check the photos. You're like, seriously, before doing this, I don't know the difference between artillery and a tank. They look very similar, I have to tell you. So this is what we end up with. So we are trying to, basically, I think the information is, the message is simple, right? Sometimes you might already know this, even before you see this. You will know, yeah, they're trying to show more and more powerful weapons, more and more missiles, less, you know, childish artillery or rockets, yes. But you don't really know this until you see the data. That's the thing, right? Sometimes after you do visualization, the message is so simple, maybe kindergarten kids know that, but you don't know why and you're not verified. That's what we're trying to do. We have to support our conclusions. So we also show the first time a model has shown up on the parade, which has a black dot. And we also show photos if you get photos from Reuters. And actually, a couple of the new models shown this year, they actually fired a couple months later. And then we went into some details. Oh, there's some funny pieces for you. This is the after parade. They also have the civilians coming by with smiley faces. And then we go into scripting. We also scrape data, but if some data can be scraped, which basically means they're already out there, you can always copy and paste if you're willing to, if you're brave enough, or you have nothing else to do. So we do scrape sometimes. I think. Oh yes. So this thing, we didn't end up with any works because we're running out of time, but I did scrape the data. We're trying to do a piece to, not really, for the anniversary of Hong Kong's return. And we're trying to see the change of the landscape in Hong Kong, like high rises. So this is a database of all the high buildings in Hong Kong. And this thing, you maybe think, yes, I can just copy and paste it. Yes, you could, but sometimes you would know when you copy and paste, the format totally messed up. They're not like this anymore. Plus, we're looking for more detailed information. If you go click on one buildings, they'll give you more information, like which construction companies is building this, how high it is, and who's the architect, or who's the developer, and what's the ranking of the buildings. We also want these details. So there's thousands of these buildings. You have to click on one of them, and then you copy and paste all these information. Just imagine how long it's going to take you. And we really wouldn't want to do this. So we just write scrippers. I personally use Python, like Beautiful Soup, for scraping. I guess that's like 60% of the content I know about Python. But some of my colleagues, they may use JavaScript. You can also use Node to scrape things. It's just personal preference. I think it will help you a lot if you know scraping, just to make sure the website does allow you to scrape. And so a couple questions when we were collecting data that we really need to think about is, if you are using the public databases, so you may wonder who collected. It really matters. For example, we're doing the drug war things, the police collected their records for many of the data. Is it really reliable? Because you're relying them to tell you how many people they killed. Is it really reliable? You may need to double check something, right? Because the experiences was that they published data, then after a couple weeks, they revised it. They were saying, we didn't kill that many. It's actually this little. So you have to ask that question. And more importantly, how they collected. Is that like voluntarily entered? Like a police officer coming back saying that, hey, I want to sign up this person I killed. Or it's mandatory, you have to sign up. Or if you were doing a survey, what is your sample size and the demographics of the person you interviewed? It's very important, because if your data is biased, your conclusion is totally inaccurate. And anything was excluded, the same thing like how they collected. If they purposely excluded some really important aspects of it. And also that's for scraping. Is a scrape allowed? There is a way you can check if the website is allowing you to scrape. So once you get data, the second step is you have to clean your data, right? Because honestly, it's a very tedious work. Sometimes it may take more than half of your time when you do a project as you are cleaning. And tools we use, Excel, which is very common. And I used to use OpenRefine, but I haven't used it for a long time. And I use R if the data set is really big. But honestly, we are not really doing big data, so like a couple gigabytes data. We are not that level yet. Sometimes I'm just not patient enough to deal with Excel, because you know when the data file is a little bit big, Excel may crash or doing very slow, and R can help you a lot. And also because I like to run SQL queries. So if you use R, you know, you can install those packages where you can do those things in R, which is really helpful, because for the piece we did on the dead arrival, the drug war thing, the spreadsheet we got, they're in different formats. Like one of them, they have all these unique case numbers and with geolocations, like exactly where they got killed. But they don't have if they're dead on arrival or dead at scene. That information was in another sheet. But luckily, they also paired with the unique case numbers. So what you can do very quickly is you run a SQL query. You can just combine two data sets together, which is really helpful, instead of copying and pasting, you know, like thousands of them. And if you know JavaScript a lot, you can also use JS to clean and manipulate your data. And if you're interested, I have a very useful, handy website. It teaches you a lot of things, how to use JavaScript to clean and analyze the river data. And regular expressions you could use it. So things to note when we clean our data is, format, that's the main purpose of cleaning our data. And we have to turn them into a clearly formatted CSV or a JSON file in order to be visualized later. And then if there are any duplications, you cannot double count them, right? Because if they're actually the same person, you were counted twice, which means your data is not accurate. And typos, sometimes it happens, like two places, they're actually one in the same places, but they spell in a slightly different way. So you have to figure out those, which OpenRefine can actually help you a lot if you're trying to deal with these kind of stuff, and regular expressions too. And if there are any inaccurate informations, or if there are any like missing data points, and if it's obviously got manipulated by the person who's typing the data. And and also back up your raw data. It's very important. I was like, I messed this up. Where's my raw data? It's already gone. And then our next step was to analyze the schedulers. So analyzer, usually for small ones, you can use a pivot table, which is really helpful too. Or you can use Google Fusion table, which I don't use that much anymore. But I use the last two lots, because in R, you know, you use ggplot, you can easily do some very ugly visualization. But very fast. So, especially if we're doing like a tree maps or something Excel cannot do, you can use R. But for us, we want things to look beautiful. We don't want to publish any ugly pieces. So the benefits of using R is you can export as SVG files, which can be stylized any way you want in Illustrator, or if you're using any other vector softwares. So which can be really helpful. And if you do that, you can also turn your SVG into interactives. But the only downside is it's not dynamic. Next time your data set got updated, you have to go through the process all over again. Or you can just use JavaScript. Things to note, backup is always the case. And you can also write data log, like how step by step you've been analyzed data, because my experience is that I always like to experiment, so you do many versions of different analysis. You're trying to see if demographic play a job, or if ages matters, or if I group them into different categories, does that show any interesting patterns? So you end up with many versions. Sometimes it confuses you, like which is the original version, or how did I end up with this version? So writing a data log is very important if it's possible. And do spot checking, because if you do too many analyses, you might make small mistakes in the process, and it's hard to check. So it's always helpful at the end, you do some spot checking, and also do some simple calculations, just see if the sum numbers matches with the raw data, because sometimes it doesn't. And then that's the end, the last step. You have to polish and code it, or annotate it, your visualizations. So we have different ways, depends on what end product we want it to look like, and also what kind of data we are having. So we will use illustrators to creating SVGs, like those maps, they're all created in illustrators, but we annotate them. But we use, instead of just saving them as a high resolution PNG, we use AI2HTML, which means your text is still in the code. It's only your base is a picture. So when people, especially it's helpful, like when people are searching your stuff, all the text still can be keywords in Google search. And also it's higher resolutions because they're vectors. AI2HTML is a free plugin for illustrators. If you're doing a lot of like web design, those graphic design stuff, it's really helpful. Just check it out. It's built by New York Times, I think. And then SVGs is related. And D3, I bet many of you using D3 for data visualizations. It's really helpful. Sometimes hard to learn, but you can do a lot of things. For the dead on arrival map, we created the map with SVG, but we manipulated the animation process using D3. You can select them whatever way you want and animate them, and to control their like speed or the way of pop up, things like that. And then for building the web pages, it's very simple, you'll know that. And for maps, I use QGIS because it's free. And things to note when you do data viz, is your color scheme like a color blend friendly? We actually made that mistakes before. We did some election graphics, and when somebody pointed out, they were looking at graphics, they were like, I clearly not tell any difference, like which is which party, because it's not color blind friendly, which is really important, especially for doing election coverage. They all look the same. How do you know who won? So it's very important. And there are some sources out there, like a color blur. You can just pick color blend friendly colors and follow the design principles. I'm not like a design expert. My colleagues can tell you better things, but like the proximity, if it's clear, if premises. Also aligned to the final point, responsive, is your visualization responsive? Because it's very important. I mean, nowadays, who's really checking the things on a laptop with a huge screen, right? Because majority of them just check them on the phone. So it's very important your work is responsive, otherwise it just looks shitty. And also for the interactions. I think when we first started or in school, we had this fantasy of like, everything has to be interactive, right? So fun. How boring this thing is, like static. You cannot click on anything, or right? But the thing is that how many people are literally clicking on those graphics? You have buttons here, you have hover over, like hover me. They're not going to hover. And so, which you really need to make sure is your piece clearly, like using message out there, even assuming people are not gonna click or hover or scroll on anything. So here just like two very quick case studies about how the process we went to create these pieces. This is another North Korea graphic. We did this, is about, we're trying to analyze the relationships between North Korea and South Korea. Because when they elected a new South Korean president, he's really willing to talk to the enemies. But we want to see how the history was like, how friendly they were, and if there's any patterns we can figure out. And so our data source is this, is the Ministry of Unifications. They publish a lot of data. They have all the historical, like the meetings they had between two countries and the agreements they made between two countries. And it's kind of like in a very clear format already. It looks like a real formatted table. You can copy and paste. The problem is that you have to select every year manually from 1971 to 2017 and then copy and paste. And I mean, fingers crossed, well-formatted. So we write a scraper for this. Because one good thing about this, if you have scraped before, and if you inspect the web pages, you will find actually in your web pages, all the data source is already in the JavaScript file. You actually don't need to click on all the tabs. They actually load the data set one time. So if you just scrape it, it's super fast. Instead of clicking like 40 times and copy and paste and clean format, it just saves you a lot of time, and it's actually very simple. So our final data set for this, it will be just look like something like that. This is the dialogue they have, and we do the similar things for the agreements. And then we do some sketch, trying to think about how we're gonna visualize this. This is the rough sketch at the beginning. So we have years on the left, and we're trying to categorize them into different times under different presidents to see if they have any patterns, because you know, different presidents have different policies which will dramatically increase or influence the possibility they talk to each other or make any agreements. And then after this, we're thinking about maybe we should add more like events. For example, North Korea was trying to assassinate someone from South Korea, or their boat was trying to cross the borders and creating some nuances, and then it will influence their relationship too. And then, this is how our piece looks like. The reason it's called New Dawn because the previous president, they had this policy called Sunshine Policy, which means they had really a really good relationship between two countries, like sunshine, very warm. So we're trying to say if this new president gonna bring back the Sunshine Policies and bring like dawn a little bit sunshine. So instead of having presidents on the side, we just chop them into different stages and have their headshots, and then we add accidents, incidents, categorize them into different kinds of dialogues, and we're trying to annotate them. And importantly, we're trying to indicate when they exactly started their tenure. And you can hover over these. But we kill the tooltip for all the talks, because seriously, nobody really care about what you guys have talked. It's more importantly how many times you have talked in a year, the numbers. So it's a very data-driven piece, not very much like human faces or touching stories, but it's the data itself tells the story. Like some periods, they just barely talked. Like this guy. They're literally talking for the whole year. This year, they had a lot of agreements. In some years, they had a lot of accidents. Oh, so one another thing was, when we were thinking about the legends, this one. So it's clear here, and when you're looking at this one, it's still clear. But when you scroll here, do you still remember which is which? You don't, right? So we end up with something like that. You have a sticky legends still staying on the page. It's just because you will no idea what these colors and icons are if you're at this stage of the page. So thinking about that thing is very important. So the second one is the piece already saw, it's the dead arrival pieces. And this is what we came across, the process. This is the sketch one. I roughly plotted for one area as an experiment. So I used different colors for dead arrival and dead at scenes. And you know, ugly colors for hospitals too, like red. And tried to see how scenes will look like. But think about this, if you were doing like two cities and you have too many colors on a page, it's actually very distracting. So we have a sketch too, we're using different colors for different areas. But then we think about this, does it really matter which areas they are in? Because this literally was telling people, hey, you're trying to send a message, these two areas are kind of different. But we're not really talking about them separately. The only difference should be between dead on arrival and dead at scene, not really geographically different. So you really see what end up with. We use the same colors for all the deaths, and we are using scrolling narrative to guide readers step by step to show the differences between DOA and the DOS. These are very specifically for news data visualizations and like investigative, how to use data in news recordings. I don't know if it's really helpful for you. I will send you guys the slideshows. And this is just like a tip of the iceberg. There are tons of information out there. And for each category, like if you're interested in R, if you're interested in just data collection or data analysis or just data visualizations, there are so many resources and tutorials, books, and useful people out there. I'm really interested to talk with you if you'd like to know like any aspects of these kind of things. Also, just let me know if you have any questions. Thanks.
All the news, including New York Times, are all creating fake news.
sorry, who's telling you in your time just creating?
Well, President of the United States.
Even a guy who tweets a lot.
Yeah, right. So I'm just interested in, because every Fox News or whichever, they have their point of view, right? And based on the hypothesis and point of view, as a journalist, how do you go align with your company's policy and then create a fake news?
Yes, fake news. That's a really good question, actually. So I don't know if you guys have seen a chart before. It's actually database. So they're trying to categorize news organizations into left, right, and Reuters is literally in the middle. So we are not biased. And mainly because we're not American media, I guess. So I know it's hard when you do reportings and you try to be very fair and not biased by your presumptions, because we're all educated human beings. We have something we believe. We don't support some people. We secretly believe in something. That's true. But when you do reportings, one sum of rule we have is that if the story you write, the way you write the story, the way you present information, if the character is not this guy, the character is actually your relative or your friend, do you still think it's a fair story? If you think, no, it's definitely not fair, then you may have some problem, right? Because you, and also, it's, we always leave rooms that you have to have different sides of the stories. Like, let's say if you're writing an article trying to criticize this company or this person, you have to give this person or company the opportunity to, let's say, clarify, or at least make their own statement, right? So that's the thing. You cannot say, hey, we found this breaking news. This guy is bribed. We're taking some illegal money. We write about this. No, we have to contact this guy. We have to tell him what information we have. So we tell him everything we have. So you have every right to fight back, to explain, to clarify if you do have evidence to prove yourself. So that's the thing. I think it's very important. It's a really great question. It's hard to be 100% non-biased, let's be honest, because sometimes I would think I'm a really like a fair and idealistic people. I have my own belief. I don't judge anybody, but honestly, sometimes I secretly do. So it's just, I think it's a matter of practice. You have to, like, also you're not alone. You have your editors, your colleagues. They're criticizing the pieces too, right? Sometimes you contribute too much. It's almost like you're a baby. You're like, no, it's perfect. But when a person who's outside of this, or who knows nothing about this topic, they're actually coming from the perspective, maybe you're a normal reader or something, when they read it, like, nah, it doesn't make sense, or it's biased, it's unfair. So I think that there are many things in the reporting process you can make sure to avoid this. And specific for visualizations, I think the way you visualize information sometimes can create bias. It's definitely like you're making this thing very huge when it's actually not that huge, or you're trying to emphasize this too much when it's actually not that important, or you should leave this opportunity or the rights to the readers to decide which is more important. So that's something we should like think about or trying to avoid when we do things like that. And does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Can I ask about the process that you guys take to create the visualizations?
Yes.
Mainly about the context. Like, normally, what's the scale of, well, how big is the team that actually operates on a specific piece? Like the time scales that you're dealing with, and then the division of the time scales. So, how much time is actually spent? I mean, I'll use the form that you have. collecting the data, formatting the data, analyzing the data, sketching and prototyping essentially, and then polishing.
Yeah.
Like, what's the division between the four? Because like it seems like from story to story, it can be very different. Like,
yes, definitely.
Yeah.
Because for some stories, it might be very hard to get the data itself. That might be the most time-consuming part. Once you have it, maybe it's actually a very easy to plot data, right?
Maybe it's a very simple data set, people just don't want to release it. So once you have it, it doesn't take any time to visualize it. So you're right, it definitely varies from story to stories. And for, so I would say for sketching, it's actually not taking that much time because we're roughly scheduled, right? You're not like going to every details because you can always polish this when in the process of coding. And getting data definitely takes time because you leave the control to other people. You're waiting, right? Like, because sometimes they never respond or they respond after a month. What can you do within that month? You can do contact multiple sources, see if you get like faster speed to get the data you want. And for cleaning, really depends on how hard you work. You can work like overnight and it may help. Cleaning also depends on how dirty the data is, like you know that, right? So it's definitely varies from story to story. And in terms of how big our team is, for Asia we have around 7, which is actually fairly small if you compare to other big news organizations. And we always running, like don't have much time to do all the projects we want to do, like the Hong Kong projects, I script data, but we end up not doing anything with that. So it happens a lot. We always want to have a bigger team with a diverse background, but you know, corporate world always are challenging. And do you have other questions?
Sorry.
Time scale, oh, how many people work on each basis? It's not fixed. It also depends on what other projects you're having in your hand currently and who's available for these kind of things or who's more familiar with this topic. And maybe we'll have our own stresses. Maybe I'm doing more about data and some colleagues really good at designs, someone maybe better at coding. Then you can cooperate together. That's the process. And yes?
Better people sitting here can answer the questions. sampling, it's actually quite difficult to move between the data, which is the macro view, and the character-driven stories, which are very small, tiny, you know. So I'm just wondering, from storytelling point of view, how do you kind of get that to work?
I can give you a couple examples. For this one, we have both their contacts and human faces. So these three guys actually died in one police operation at the same place. So we think it's a really strong news pack and storytelling way. Instead of opening with a lot of dots or cold numbers to the readers, we're starting with this simple one case about how these three guys who are innocent got killed at one night in one place. And now we're trying to dig into their stories, like the two sides of the stories is basically this case. So we do have human faces, but we also provide in the context, like there are so many people out there just like them who are innocent but got killed. And this is our map showing where these killings are happening from. And we recently did this piece. There is this 17-year-old boy got killed in Philippines drug of war last week. And we did this piece to kind of unfold the story behind it. This is like the way he got dragged by the police. So we started with his story because it's the news pack. It's a really big, sad, tragic news. And then we're showing how him, like what process it took him. That's the CCTV footage we got. And then we will got into the context. So you would think like a 17-year-old boy got killed. It's very tragic. It really happens. But apparently like 54 of minors got killed in the drug of war. So I think that's the way we do this. Like you have to have a story. Well, majority of our stories come like this. You already have a news pack. You have certain characters. You have stories to tell. And we're looking very hard to provide context, make it a bigger news. And like I said, there's opposite ways. You have a data set first, then you're trying to get people to be interviewed and trying to get stories. That happens too, but much less than this one. So it's most of the time starting with the characters is easier. Yes.
Thank you for the excellent presentation. Statistical tools being used by agencies to answer the question that was being raised. Yes, what are the common tools being used? If no, are you concerned that there's a possibility the story will change based on the lack of looking at some specific statistics?
I'm sorry, can you repeat your question?
Are statistical tools being used to look at the big data?
Uh-huh.
If yes, are there specific tools used for big data? If no, are you concerned that your story, your conclusion may be changed?
Are you talking about things like the statistical rigor of the data?
Yeah, the big data, right? Usually you look at the trend, the trend, as in the clearly speaking, that's the mean over time. Yeah.
So, like, for example, are you saying things like that the p value needs to be, the data science, the p value needs to be a certain number so that it's not.
Oh, are you saying that if we're using our data to claim we find this trend, if it's really a trend, if it's statistically accurate? That's a very good question. I think as Reuters, we actually don't do that much in terms of these kind of data visualizations. But if you're really into statistics, you may know 538. Do you know 538?
I'm sorry.
538 is a news website. So they're really good at statistics modeling, but it's also news storytelling. Nick Silver, who founded this website, is an awesome statistician, and he's really awesome at predicting election results. But
but he failed.
Yeah. I was gonna say.
We wouldn't judge that one.
It was a good example of what not to
but
do.
It's an awesome place to check if you're really into statistics and how statistical modeling was used in use visualizations. Like 538 is definitely a reliable source. I would say definitely better than Reuters. And because we're covering more like general news, so maybe not that statistically accurate. We also don't really make those bold statements saying that we have this small kind of data and we're predicting this thing gonna be selling 20 times more than this year. So we don't do that. But this website, they have tons of data, information, predictions, statistic models you can check out if you're really interested. Yes.
I think Steve Ballmer from X Microsoft is also releasing a ton of data publicly.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Oh yes, they built a like an open database or something.
Yes, correct.
Yes.
To read by some people and leave them out?
Yes, I get your point, which is very important. I think one purpose we do data visualization is actually turn complicated data into more understandable formats. So if you visualize it and people are saying, this is very complicated, I can't even understand it, it's a failure. You definitely failed at visualizing this. So because what's the difference of seeing your graphic than reading the raw data? It doesn't make any difference. So the purpose of your visualization should be easy to understand and doing a better job to educate people what this data is trying to tell you. And even they're not statistically, well, let's say if you're trying to say like this thing, like the p-value is this, blah, blah, blah. You cannot say that in your graphic, right? Who knows p-value is if you haven't taken the statistic classes. But you can say this means like higher possibility or like it's more reliable, this trend gonna become true, things like that. You have to use like human words to tell the story and do your visualizations. So that concern, yes, but if you do see that happening, that means you have to visualize it maybe in a different way or try to chop them into different small qubits instead of a very complicated one piece. Yes.
Yeah, first of all, thank you. It was very compelling, the visualization. My question is, once Reuters collect and once you do pieces with data, are you putting them on an open database or do you package it, sell it to companies? Like what's your policy with the data you're using?
So our policy is that we don't, yes, that's a very good question because I know many news media like ProPublica, they do publish their data, right? Like they share this with you, like Guardians, they share it with you, which is really awesome. We don't do that a lot actually, because we are like a newswire and we actually sell our products to other medias. And actually Straits Times is also one of our clients. but one thing I'm gonna tell you about like websites. Many cases you can expect your web pages, sometimes data is hidden in that, right? So which means it's already public. But maybe for our map, you cannot really get the raw data. That's actually a really good point because maybe we should do these more and more. Like,
as a journalist, doesn't it make sense that other people can check what conclusions you
draw definitely from the data? It's like you're telling your, like how we interview our own data,
yeah.
Like how other people are collecting this, what methodology they used. You're right, we should do the same thing. Like tell your readers how we collected our data and how we analyzed it, and you can judge if it's accurate or biased or not. Yeah, that's a really good suggestion. We do this sometimes, but not for many of them. Maybe we should do this more.
And one more subsidiary question. So I know you guys sell financial data to companies.
Yes, we do.
Yes. What about other type of data?
What do you mean other type of data?
I don't know, to marketing companies or... It's a question, I have no clue.
To marketing companies?
Yeah, like, do any company approach you and wants to buy data that you collect? Or?
Well, they don't really contact our editorial people. We have our sales team, finance team, who are dealing with clients. They're the face who you need to talk to if you wanna. Sometimes we do get emails to our sales people saying that, hey, we saw Reuters publish this graphic. We're really interested in the data set behind it, where we can get this data. And then our sales team may approach us saying that, hey guys, where did you get your data? Our clients want it. Then that's maybe a way they can get our data, but they don't usually contact us directly, and we don't have like a policy to really dealing with clients.